down. How many of you have heard about it? Jupiter, formerly known as Hyperion, or branched out of Hyperion. So I'm also going to touch a little bit on machine learning. So my name is Tendai, and my background is in computer science and information security, cyberforensics. I'm a lecturer at Harare School of Technology. You might have seen it last year coming down the road there. I also do data analytics, digital forensics, and I'm also an entrepreneur. If you're a Zimbabwean, you're actually an entrepreneur. Because the economy forces you. And here's some of the things I like all the other kids. So before we start, I guess we can define what research is. Research will differ depending on what you're doing. We can define it as research is a careful and detailed study into a specific problem, concern, or issue using the scientific method. Basically, what we'll be trying to do is we'll be trying to answer a certain number of questions. What, who, where, when, why, how. And when you find answers to this question, you gain knowledge. So you might be trying to answer a specific idea or a specific question. It might be new, or it might be old. Sometimes that knowledge might be new to you, but it might be known to someone, but it's still research to you. So what is research in my line of work? It's my academic research, students' projects, consultancy work, students' coursework, that can be assignments or mini projects, random programming tasks, as well as collaborative work with colleagues. So when you're researching, there's a life cycle you follow. You have an idea, you formulate a hypothesis, and you want to answer that hypothesis. So you have your tools which you use to write. It can be Word, it can be your IDE, it can be a notebook where you're writing and you're getting information, you're writing it down. So you capture your data. With your data, you make analysis, so you carry out experiments. And you use certain softwares to do your analysis. And then afterwards, you visualize. And normally in academia, after you've done all your experiments, you publish a paper. That's the most important one. And throughout the course of that life cycle, you use commercial tools, public tools. You use other tools like GitHub, community portals, journals. You get information from a lot of people. And then you have your output, which is your academic paper. But usually when you read an academic paper, I don't know how many of you have read an academic paper, you might see a lot of mathematical equations. They'll tell you we did this and this and this, but when you try to recreate it, you don't know what they did. You can't even follow what they did. And sometimes when you see the formulas, it's daunting. You're just like, I'll leave this. That's where the idea of reproducible research comes in. When you make research, you should be able to be reproduced by someone else. Not only replicated, but if someone else is, will get that research, they should be able to follow what you did, to follow the train of thought that you had when you were doing a particular task, and be able to reproduce it. Either given the same data or given different data, everything should be clearly laid out. So some of the definitions we have, this is from the R project. How many of you have heard of R? The goal of reproducible research is to tie specific instructions to data analysis and experimental data so that scholarship can be recreated, better understood, and verified. So imagine if you just come and you say, no, the Earth is a square. How are people going to verify that? So your research has to be reproducible. So what is the problem in my line of work? Documentation. Students they make a lot of projects, and it's very hard to keep track of what they're doing. Sometimes it's hard to know if they've copied code. Sometimes it's hard to know where they're going with the idea from the first step until the final project. Usually what happens is you have an idea, initially you prototype, you go through iterations, and then finally you have a solid output. So the steps that happen from ideation or the beginning of the idea until the final product, they are very hard to document. Another thing is recreation of solutions. This can be a programming assignment, this can be a data analysis assignment, or this can be research. Again, trying to make sense of academic papers, as I said, collaborating on projects. You might be working together on a project and you want to work together. There are a lot of tools which can help you to do that. There are things like Slack, things like Google Docs. But we try to find that something that can fit within the scientific sense or the programming sense. I'll give you a practical example of my thesis. When I was doing my master's, you would have a lot of files. You would have file 1, file 2, file 3. Sometimes you have final. I don't know how many of you have done that.
Really final this time.
Yeah, really final this time. That can apply to code also. So sometimes you end up getting confused with your own work. I know when it comes to source code, you can have things like version control, which can help you in that. But in terms of tracking a project, your own ideas in your head, let's say you go to a project 6 months later down the road, will you understand what you're doing? Yes, you might have documentation, you might have comments in the code, but will you understand the idea, what you're trying to achieve? You might not be able to do that. So my research was 100 malware detection using machine learning. So for those of you who are not aware what machine learning is, the guy who came up with it defined it as a field of study that gives a field of study that gives computers the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. So we're saying if you give a computer some data, let's say you want to differentiate between water and juice, you give it a random sample of water and juice, maybe 100,000 samples. After that, it should be able to say, when you give it a new test case, it should be able to say this is water or this is juice. So we're trying to apply the same thing to Android malware. And Android runs a software that's called an APK, I'm sure all of you are aware of that. So the way we did it was, this was like, I think, a couple of years ago. We used permissions as the features which we determine if this is malware or benign application. So it fell under what is known as supervised machine learning. There are two kinds, the supervised and unsupervised. Supervised, you're basically giving it data for each tool to learn. And unsupervised is the opposite. So our focus on supervised. In supervised, there are two main problems, classification and regression. Classification mainly deals with two classes, either one or zero, or true or false. Telling if something is what you want it to be, and then regression, usually you'll be dealing with specific values, like trying to predict houses or house prices or things like that. So now, using Python, my project I use Python. How would you go about building a predictive model in Python? This applies to basically any other language, but in Python, you import your required modules, which is sklearn or scikit-learn. You get your data. In this case, the data was, I think I had about 800 applications. So these APKs, you need to extract the permissions from them, save them to a database, and then you also have a malware. At that particular time, there wasn't a lot of malware. You could get it from different sources. I had about, I think, 300, 400 malware applications. Again, you extract the permissions, you store them in the database, you select your classifier, then you feed your features into your classifier, you feed your data to your model, then you get your predictions, and then you evaluate. And then that is an iterative process. You keep repeating over and over again. And then in the end, the final product was a web application, which used Flask, and anyone could submit an application. And then it would classify it as malware or or benign application. And then using those applications, after a specific period of time, it will train the model again until it kept on getting better. So the big question now is, the big question becomes, after all that, after I've done all that, I won't be doing it alone, but I have to communicate with my supervisor. And then later on, I might need to show students, like maybe someone is doing something similar that they need, like a hand, not to do it. So how can I make it easy to understand, not overload the students with unnecessary things? I would have to answer, how did I do it? How did I set up everything? When did I make the changes and what were they? And how can I share it? So throughout the course of the thesis, the things I would do, I would code on my own using Python. Initially, I started using PyCharm, and then PyCharm was a big overkill. Then I went to Sublime, and then I found out about IPython then. And then I fell in love with it. So during that process, I would have to email my supervisor scripts, random Python code, so that they can go over it. And then tell me, maybe edit this, change this. And then it was a lot of work. And then I would have to copy and paste that code into either a PPT for the reviews, or a docx, or a PDF. And then again, I would learn new tools. And then I would have to iterate again. Like initially, I used Weka. I don't know if you've heard about it. It's a Java based. It's really good for prototyping, but it's not good if you want to do something quickly, like play around with code and move on. So the question is, how can we make all of this easier? That's where things like Jupyter come in. What Jupyter is it's a notebook. It enables you to have all your code. You can have code, you can have videos, you can have PDFs. And have a lot of content within the same place. And you can share it with anyone. You just need to give them the data that you access from there, and then you can share it with them, and then they can access it. So how do you get it? It's an independent project that is found, but it is found within Anaconda. Anaconda is developed by a company called Continuum. And they put it together. Most of the libraries that are used in scientific application, in business application, in high performance computing, and you can find it all in one place. So if you want to get started in data analytics, scientific things, machine learning, I would recommend you to download the Anaconda. And then within there you can get Jupyter. I'll show you how it runs. So Python is a language which allows you to do a lot of things. You can make applications, you can make web applications like Jupyter. You can make 100 applications like Dallas presented. You can make business intelligence applications, distributed systems. And then Anaconda, like I said, it brings everything together. You have diverse sectors or sections of programming that you or business that you can work from. And who can use it? It can be used by data scientists, developers, DevOps, engineers, business analysts, or computational scientists. So most of you might be wondering, okay, Fred Masters is talking about. So I'll give you a demo on how it works. And some of this might be a bit technical, but I'll try to explain how. You can add everything you need within your project. You can have SQL, Alchemy that Peter was talking about. You can have support from the community. It comes installed with Jupyter, Qt console, and Spider. Spider is an IDE for those who like IDEs. So then you launch your Jupyter. I've already launched mine. After it's launched, it will open a page in the browser that will contain a folder where you can access the folders where your IPython notebooks will be. The IPython notebooks or the Jupyter notebooks come with the IPYNB extension. And then it will show you the running notebooks. And then if you're connected to either an HPC or a computer that can run parallel processes, it will show you here. And then Conda, you can run your commands there if you want. So you open one notebook. This is the notebook for the malware detection. So it will have a number of options. You can add code, you can add markdown, you can add raw text, you can add a heading. And then to run each line, it will operate as if it's the interpreter. So if you want to explain things, so for example, this is 100 malware classification. This is section one. We're getting our data. Once we get our data, we need to clean it. And then here, I specify what I'm doing. I'm using machine learning to classify malicious applications and benign applications. I'm using Pandas. Pandas is a library which is used for data analysis. A rudimentary explanation of it would say it's like Excel with steroids in Python. You can do anything you can do in Excel, you can do it there. The only difference is you need to do it programmatically. So we import our functions. We use Pandas, and then there's another library which is called NumPy. So each stage, after you click run, it will move to the next cell, and then it will run that cell. In this case, we are opening a CSV file named data. And this CSV file contains data which we took from our APKs. So each APK we have permissions. So we extract the permissions from the APK and we use them as our feature in our machine learning algorithm or in our model. The extraction of the APK permissions was done using Python again, but I didn't put that in the iPython notebook. So after we open the CSV, we open it as a data frame. And a data frame is a table of index values. So it will basically store everything that is within our CSV file, which we opened in Excel just now. And it will show up like this. So it will have rows and columns just like an Excel table. So initially, we have our applications. They are benign and they are malware. But when we're dealing with classifications, we need to have binary values, which is a 0 and a 1, which are the two classes we have. So we have 0 for benign and 1 for malicious. So we can take our classification and run a function which is called unique, which will check the objects within our column and name each unique value. So in this case, we only have two. Malware and benign, and we want to check that we don't have wrong values within our data set. So we go to the next one. We want to change the text from benign to 0 and malware to 1. So we change the columns within our data frame. We are changing for each entry that is written benign, we're saying 1, for each entry that is malware, we're saying 1, and we save it as an integer. And then now we print our data frame again. And you can see that everything has been changed. So now we want to list the info. So this is basically anything that you can do in Excel. In Excel you can see how many rows you have, you can see how many columns you have. But now we're just doing it programmatically. It's much easier, okay, maybe not easier, but it's much faster for you to do things in code as opposed to GUI. I know some of you might have a different opinion. So we count our entries, then we go to the next one. Since we have created a new column which has the binary values, we drop the one with the text values. Now we want to update. We want to list all the permissions that we have in our data frame. This was a bit overkill. This was the first iteration of the project. So I used to take all the permissions, and some of them were redundant. Like almost every application has them by default. So you need to cut it down if you're doing your own machine learning program and find which features are really necessary for your problem. So you have functions like get and head. You tell it how many rows to print. It only prints, in this case, one for you. You can change it to print two if you want. So if you're doing data analysis, I would recommend this tool for you. So again, here we run the info, we check. Now we want to assign our training values. In machine learning, we have what's called a training set and a test set, or a validation set. Where after you train, you want to check whether what you train is really working. So we can split it. We have our train data. And then again, like I was saying, when you're going through a project, you might make mistakes. So, like in this case, I made a mistake and it was not running, so I can comment it out. But I also leave it, so that if I'm giving it to a student later on or to a colleague, they will know not to go in that direction. I can even add a comment like, don't touch this, this is... So we go to this, to the next section. Section 2 is the machine learning and the training of the model. In this case, this is after you've done a bit of prototyping. When you're still prototyping, you want to choose which classifier really works for you, and you check all the accuracy scores. So in this case, we're using a random forest classifier. So we use our training data to fit it to our model. Our model is a random classifier. So we fit it. Here we're just selecting the columns from our data frame. So we fit it into there, then we load our test data. As you can notice here, we had app data, which was a training set. Now we load the test set, which is another CSV. We print our CSV. We assign it to a NumPy array. We predict from our model. And then from our prediction, we have an application ID. So because we want to compare if our prediction was correct. And then we compare the initial data we had in the result to see if the original classification is same as the classification we got from our machine learning algorithm. And then we have our recall, our precision and our F1 score. You can also have your confusion matrix. You can have your accuracy score. And this, you can save it like this. And all you need is the data. You can give it to someone else later on, and they can use it for their research. So I would like to think that if you're doing your project, if this is particularly the prototyping, something like this can be very useful for you if you're doing it in Python, and particularly now with Jupyter. Before, when it was IPython, it was only focused on Python. Now you can even create your own kernel. You can have your own language. If you don't want to do it, I know it's a Python conference on. But if you don't want, you can have your own. You can even have R. You can have Julia. You can have any language you want. So I had, I don't know if, maybe if you have time, some other time, you can have a lab, or I can give you guys if you want to go and do it. This one is used for information security. It takes a log from a bro IDS. We heard about bro or IDS in general, intrusion detection system. Okay, basically we call it a firewall. So it takes a log from the firewall So let's say you have your VPS and you take the authentication log and you want to see the number of brute force attacks you had, something that you might need a special software for, or you might pay someone for, you can do it on your own. You get your log, you open it, you count how many things are in the log, you verify inputs, you check IDs of IPs which have been trying to access your VPS. You can summarize your data. You can see how many, the count of how many IP addresses have tried to access. You can check the packets. It can list the data types for you. You can check services, like for specific services, if you want SSL, if you want SSH, if you want SMTP. So you can do all those things for yourself. If you want to see someone who's trying to brute force your email service, you can do all those things for you. For the students who are here, you can quickly have a tool for security analysis if you want. So there are a lot of things which you can do, and you will see immediate results there. And you can actually see where your code is going wrong instead of waiting for the interpreter to run or using the interpreter and then checking, then going back typing again, checking, going back typing again. So for those who want, you can see me, then I can give you this. And for those who have Windows, I have the installations from. If you want, you can get them from me. So thank you guys. Any questions?
Thank you.
From your, when you started that, I imported NumPad. So I tried, I'm actually learning about NumPad. So I really want to know exactly how it fits with Python. Because from what I saw, you didn't actually use NumPad.
No, I used NumPad. NumPad, I think I mentioned it quite fast. NumPy only works with zeros and ones. Whereas pandas, they store the data frame, which is basically, you can even have text. But now when it's NumPy, it's a numerical array. So it's more like a table, but now with zeros and ones. And so, I don't know if you've done any math. It's when you're doing, it's easier to deal with matrices. And when you're doing vectorization, when you're dealing with vectors, it's easier for you to deal with matrices. So NumPy is sort of like an extension of MATLAB to be in Python.